डॉक्टर ध्रुमिल पटेल, थैंक यू लोतिका एंड थैंक यू डॉक्टर बंसी भाई फॉर गिविंग मी द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू टॉक फॉर ए वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक ऑफ डायबिटिक किडनी डिजीज. फॉर्चुनेटली प्रोफेसर ग्रोव हैज लेफ्ट नथिंग फॉर मी टू गिव ऑल द रिसेंट ट्रायल्स इन द लास्ट डिकेड रिगार्डिंग द डायबिटिक किडनी डिजीज. But even though I have selected few trials for all of you, which have either designed primarily for the renal outcome, or which have the dent in the management of diabetic kidney disease, these are my disclosures. What I'll be dealing in the next 15 or 18 minutes regarding the different clinical trials have been designed primarily for DKD. And Professor Grob has already been emphasized regarding the mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists, SGLT2 inhibitors and GLP-1 receptor agonists. But I'll try to summarize for all of you these clinical trials. But before that, I'll give you very recent publication from KDIGO. Only 1 week before, this publication was there by KDIGO, and that says that there are 10 commandments for diabetic kidney disease in last decade. Of course, Professor Grob has already been given all the details regarding this. So we have actually understood the diabetic kidney disease and changed our understanding regarding pathophysiology to the management of diabetic kidney disease in last decade. We have actually seen the integrated approach, which is very, very important because diabetes and kidney disease have multi-system disorders. So it is not a single thing which is important. And the patients need healthy eating, exercise, smoking cessation as a behavioral intervention. Other than the control of glucose, lipids, and blood pressure. We should have a very proper dietary management to reduce diabetic kidney disease. And we have to understand the sodium, protein restrictions, and several things regarding dietary approach. The blood glucose tracking is the most important aspects in management of diabetic kidney disease. Of course, we have actually individualize the glycemic objectives when we manage diabetic kidney disease. Dear friends, need not to emphasize in front of you regarding the SGLT2 inhibitors because they have changed the way we treat diabetic kidney disease earlier. Regarding metformin, earlier we were afraid of using metformin in diabetic kidney disease, but recent evidence says that we can use metformin up to EGFR 30. So that is, this is the recent ones. And we have the other agents like GLP-1 receptor agonists, which are again very, very important in the management of diabetic kidney disease. We have certain blockers of renin-angiotensin systems, which are very, very useful in diabetic kidney disease. We have changed the management strategies in the last decade. And all these factors actually are recommendation-based or guideline-based on research, which we have seen in last decade. I need not to emphasize all these things. Dr. Grob has already been alluded to. And this is how our kidney disease progressed from hyperfiltration to microalbuminuria to macroalbuminuria and ultimately lead to end-stage renal disease. The only thing here, the glycemic control is the key for management of diabetic kidney disease. And here, this is a study which was actually presented in ESD in Barcelona, and which says that if you see here, the glycosylated hemoglobin, actually, if you control the glycosylated hemoglobin, you can probably check the DKD development. Now, regarding the presence and severity of CKD, one of the best and easiest markers of type 2 diabetes is the albuminuria. And I think Professor Group has earlier emphasized that albuminuria is one of the important markers for the risk of diabetes as well as for the progression of diabetes. This is again a study which was published recently in New England Journal of Medicine, which is known as Ischemia CKD study, which clearly says that managing coronary disease in the advanced kidney disease, we have like this here in this study, the 700 patients around with the death or with stable coronary artery disease. And then these patients were, either given the invasive strategy or the conservative care for the management. And what we found in this study that there was no difference in Seattle angina Kushner in summary score, whether we do invasive or the conservative. The overall conclusion is that invasive treatment did not reduce the death or non-fatal myocardial infarction or improve angina-related health status. That means that we have to be, conservatively can manage diabetic kidney disease. So, dear friends, we should have a comprehensive care of patients with diabetic kidney disease, right from your lifestyle modification to control glucose, lipids, and the blood pressure. Then we should employ the drugs like SGLT2 inhibitors and RAS blockade, and if needed, antiplatelet therapies are needed. Already, you have seen the effect of steroidal mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists like finerenone. And the only thing I want to tell here is that the blockade of aldosterone using MRAs was hypothesized to be an effective strategy to attenuate the effect of aldosterone escape phenomenon and provide renoprotective effects. So dear friends, if you employ very early MRAs, you can think of renoprotective effects. And here, the Fidelio DKD, the professor group has already shown us that if you employ MRAs, you can probably reduce kidney failure by 30%, sustained eGFR decline reduction by 19%, secondary composite outcome reduction by 24%, and secondary outcome or CV morbidity and mortality reduced by 14%. What else you need from any other drug? There are so many ongoing studies with the non-steroidal MRAs, whether these are the studies, and probably by next 2 years or next year, we'll have the results of all these studies. Second, the most important molecules, which I can say wonder molecules, are the SGLT2 inhibitors. Professor Group has already shown us regarding the effect of empagliflozin. Especially, I have selected these clinical trials for you. I'll not give the details, but the conclusion of each and every clinical trials of empagliflozin, canagliflozin, and dapagliflozin. Dear friends, I've seen here the kidney outcomes with these SGLT2 inhibitors. If I can summarize here with either Canvas, Credence, DAPA-HF, Declared TIMI, DAPA-CKD, EMPA-REG, EMPA-REDUCE, or VERTIS-CV, you can see here they are all shift to left. That means the composite outcomes regarding the kidney disease are always much better when we employ SGLT2 inhibitors. So let us see the EMPA-REG studies, and what the conclusion of EMPA-REG studies clearly showed us whether any renal outcome, whether worsening nephropathy or incident or progression to macroalbuminuria, doubling of serum creatinine, initiation of renal replacement therapies, they are all shifted to left, means there are a much better renal outcomes when you give the empagliflozin. Second, canagliflozin, the CANVAS program. And the CANVAS program has also shown clearly here, all the renal outcomes are much better, right from new onset albuminuria to microalbuminuria onset to the doubling of serum creatinine or progression to ESRD, these are all better when you employ canagliflozin as compared to placebo. So if I can summarize here, the renal outcomes with canagliflozin, the renal specific outcome reduction by 34%, cardiovascular outcome reduction by 20%. And if you even think it, there is no increased risk of amputation and fractures, which were earlier thought of that the SGLT2 inhibitors can increase amputations and fractures. Dear friends, there is no increase in this particular CREDENCE trial. And if you see the declared TIMI-58 study, the renal outcomes clearly show that whether it's a composite cardiorenal outcome or renal specific outcome or sustained eGFR reduction or progression to end-stage renal disease, renal mortality, cardiovascular mortality, or progression again to end-stage renal disease or renal death, except cardiovascular mortality, you can see here they are all shipped to lead. Means renal outcomes are much better even in declared TIMI study. So declared, if you can say, the eGFR is one of the guiding factor for management of diabetic kidney disease as far as the employment of SGLT2 inhibitors, dapagliflozin, is concerned. So dear friends, the overall summarization of the renal outcome in DAPA-CKD is that the renal specific outcome reduction is by 44%, cardiovascular outcome reduction by 29%, and all-cause mortality by 31%. If I can say the primary composite outcome, if you can see here, it is reduced 39% lower risk of having eGFR decline or progression to end-stage kidney disease. So dear friends, what we have seen in EMPA-REG outcome, CANVAS, declared TIMI, and CREDENCE, if you can see here, these all studies have shown the better renal outcome with the patients even less than say, eGFR 60. That means even with established cardiovascular disease and CV risk factors, if you give SGLT2 inhibitors, you will find better renal outcome as compared to if you are not giving the SGLT2 inhibitors. So if I can compare the major SGLT2 studies in front of you, regarding the Vertice and empagliflozin renal study, the intervention is clearly with placebo here in the artugliflozin, whereby in empagliflozin renal, it is compared with the empagliflozin and placebo. So I think if we can see the progression is already been published in the Vertice study that overall renal composite outcomes are much better. Of course, we have to see the results of this EMPA renal study. Now, as far as the GLP-1 receptor agonists are concerned, we have basically available dulaglutide and liraglutide, and semaglutide is not available in India, but already been results published in the Europe and the USA. What the effect of GLP-1 receptor agonist and the renal outcomes, dear friends, if you see here, there are several studies, right, from Alexa, Leader, Sustain6, Excel, and Rewind. If I can say the overall results of all these clinical trials have shown the good effects on the renal outcome. Regarding the worsening of kidney function is concerned, again, if I can say, except Sustain6 and Alexa, you can find in other studies, the worsening of kidney function is less in the GLP-1 receptor agonist group. So dear friends, if I can give you the little results of Rewind study, if you can see here, this is the study which dulaglutide with placebo randomized control study. And again, as far as the composite renal outcomes are concerned, it is very significantly reduced by the dulaglutide. If I can show here the sustained decline here, of course, it is not significant, but it is non-inferior. But as far as new onset of macroalbuminuria concerned, it is very significant reduction by dulaglutide. And even chronic renal replacement therapy need, it is again, less, but it is not very significant. So what is the renal outcome of post hoc analysis from the REWIND trial? Except the renal mortality, if I can say all the renal outcome measures, whether the sustained GFR or decline in GFR or progression to ESRD, I think it is all shift to left. That means you have the better renal outcome when you give the GLP-1 receptor agonist dulaglutide. And even the efficacy and safety of dulaglutide in DKD stage 3 and 4. So this is also very safe. I think if you see the AWARD 7 study here, either less decline in EGFR with dulaglutide, if you can see, dulaglutide is non-inferior to insulin glargine. This is much, this is very revealing study. And more than 40% EFR decline or end-stage kidney disease with glutide versus insulin glargine is here. If you can see, glargine versus dulaglutide is comparable. So in the LEADER study, whereby liraglutide was employed, the composite renal outcome reduction is by 22%. New onset persistent microalbuminuria onset is reduction by 26%. So LEADER study has also shown us the good effect of liraglutide in renal outcomes. Whether the changes in UACR, again, the LEADER study has shown us the good effect, whether it is the MDRD or whether it is other employment. So overall summarized is that there is 22% relative risk reduction for the composite renal outcome, 26% relative risk reduction for the new onset persistent microalbuminuria. Sustained study also shown us there is a 36% risk reduction of new onset or worsening of nephropathy. Again, if I can compare the renal functions and microvascular outcome, I think the semaglutide had also shown the better clinical outcome as far as the renal outcomes are concerned. I'm going a little bit faster to actually save the time. But if I can summarize the SUSTAIN 6 study, there is reduced risk of composite renal outcome with semaglutide versus placebo. Over the course of the trial, eGFR generally decreased across treatment groups, and decrease in the UACR were generally greater with semaglutide versus smaller decrease or increases with placebo. Dear friends, there are so many ongoing trials. Just I want to name in front of you, the DAPA-CKD has already been out. EMPA-KIDNEY will be out in next year. FIDELO-DKD already been primary result, Dr. Professor Group has shown. The FLOW study will be there after 2 or 3 years. So we have several few future renal outcome trials in front of you with the SOUL, FLOW, and SELECT and REMODEL study that will again give us the new idea about how to the different understanding of the pathophysiology and the management of diabetic kidney disease. These all studies are on the way. Especially the SOUL and SELECT. This is especially semaglutide in cardiovascular outcome trials. And probably these clinical trials will give us the real idea. So in my last, there are novel treatments for diabetic kidney disease. We have seen the tremendous effect of the SGLT2 inhibitors in renal outcomes. GLP-1 receptor has shown, liraglutide and semaglutide have shown the good clinical outcomes regarding the kidney disease progression. DPP-4 inhibitors, Professor Group has already shown us the linagliptin has little dent, in the management of diabetic kidney disease. Thiazolidine diones, of course, are not available, but they have also been shown to have little bit effect on albuminuria or reduce albuminuria. We have other newer drugs like pentoxifilin, vitamin D analogs. We have the endothelial A receptor antagonists like atrasentan. We have PKC inhibitors. We have TGF beta blockers like pirfenidone. we have sulodexide, we have anti-inflammatory. The professor group has emphasized that we are actually addressing the metabolic and hemodynamic effects in the diabetic kidney disease, but we never address the inflammation and fibrosis. Probably this bardoxolone methyl and JAK inhibitors and MRAs may be able to reduce the inflammation and fibrosis in the diabetic kidney disease. So dear friends, we have several factors there which can lead to diabetic kidney disease, and we are now working on several drugs which can affect those which are causing the diabetic kidney disease. Like we have certain drugs for reducing endothelial injury, we have altered hemodynamics through the RAS inhibitors, MR antagonists and other SGLT2 inhibitors, reduction of albuminuria, reduction in fibrosis, reduction in inflammation, reduction in endothelial ER stress, and biogenetic changes. These are again very, very important regarding that it causes DKD. And dear friends, we have certain drugs which can affect or address the oxidative stress, and certain epigenetic modification may be in the future. So dear friends, this is all I can say you for the recent clinical trials in the last decade. Thank you very much for the patience listening, and I'm available for the question and answer. Dear friends, this is time for action. We have already seen the clinical trials. Now you have to have a time of action to reduce the diabetic kidney disease burden in our type 2 diabetes and type 1 diabetes patients. Thank you very much.